This is part 6 of building a Trackless Dark Ride. In this video, we're going to use some new radio modules that should be the end of all my localization problems, and we're going to hook up some laser gun targets and really have some fun. This is my Trackless Dark Ride vehicle. The goal of this project is to turn this into a ride system like you can find at Disney or Universal. The vehicle drives around on a ride profile, and then there'll be synchronized sound, lights, special effects, animatronics that make this ride a full experience. And in this video, we're gonna make it the best it's ever been. As with any R&D project, there's gonna be a ton of iterations, and I'm really excited for this one. When I started working on this ride, I thought I was gonna use a LiDAR system to navigate around the room. I ended up moving away from LiDAR, as LiDAR data is really messy and really sensitive to any changes in the room. So then I went back to the very most basic system I could think of. I used basically a line follower. So I used little IR-based color detecting sensors pointed at the ground, and those followed around a line made of tape. Now that system was great, and it really let me start working on the ride, but it wasn't trackless. So then I came up with the system that's currently on the ground now. All these ArUco markers are measured by a camera on the vehicle, and whenever the vehicle sees one of these ArUco markers, it can tell where it is. But that's not really perfect. First, it relies on me accurately being able to place down a huge grid of these wherever I take this ride. Plus, these markers on the ground are super easy to damage, really hard to remove, and extra hard to put back on. So it's not a great long-term solution. So here's what I'm gonna do instead. I'm going to use these UWB radio modules to track the location of the vehicle. These UWB modules are kind of an amazing feat of engineering. They measure the distance between each other by measuring the speed of light. So the way it works is you'll have one radio module called the marker, and then one radio module called the tag. When you want to find the distance between the two, you have the marker module send a message to the tag module. When the tag module receives that, it will then reply saying that it received it. And then while that's happening, the marker module is timing how long it takes to receive that confirmation back. Based on how long that is and knowing the constant speed of light, you can actually determine how far away these two modules are. By using four UWB modules, three set up as markers spread throughout the room, and one as a tag on the vehicle itself, we'll be able to use a process called trilateralization to locate the vehicle within the ride space. So here's the plan. One radio module goes on the vehicle. That's easy. But what I need is to have three markers with an exact known location spread throughout the room. Ideally, these three markers are at the same height off the ground as each other and as the radio module on the vehicle, and they're at a very well-known location, so I can take it on and off and take down the ride and reset it up when I need to without having to worry about remeasuring every single time. And for these known locations, I'm actually gonna use something already built into the walls. I have three outlets across the room that will make the perfect spot to mount the radio modules. So here's the plan. I'm gonna use a power supply like this, and then I'm going to mount a box with the radio module and a microcontroller in it to the power supply. The power supply will power all the electronics and provide a super easy way to mount the radio module to the wall in a fixed location every single time. Then, whenever I want to take down or put up the ride, I just plug in the power supply to the outlets, and because the outlets will never move, I know exactly where they are. Inside each of the control boxes is a Raspberry Pi Pico W. That W stands for Wi-Fi, so it will actually be able to talk to the main control system of the ride. As each of the three Raspberry Pi Picos around the room receive data from the radios they're attached to, they'll send that data to the main control system of the ride, and that main control system will be able to collect data from all three of them and perform the trilateralization to determine where the vehicle is in the ride space. In addition to talking to the radio modules, these Raspberry Pi Pico Ws will also control a few targets. And each target looks like this. It's got an IR receiver, just like I described in my laser gun video. And then it's got RGB LEDs to add some color to the targets and add more variety to the ride. The wire that comes at the side here goes to the radio boxes, which ties it to the main control system of the ride. And if you look in here, you'll actually notice that I've got custom PCBs. The PCBs I'm using for this project were provided by this video's sponsor, PCBWay. Ordering PCBs from PCBWay couldn't be any simpler. All you have to do is go in and enter the size of your PCB, enter how many you want, give a few more specifics about your design, choose your colors, and then boom, you've got your instant quote. Once you upload your Gerber files, one of their super helpful customer service representatives will actually overview your files and make sure everything's good. If anything's wrong, they'll reach out to you and you can communicate with them over email. Don't ask me how I know. Their processing and shipping is insanely fast. I ordered them Sunday night, and they got to me in America by Thursday night. The boards themselves look great. I really like this black and white combo. The solder screen is perfect, the silk screen is perfect, soldering has been super easy. Be sure to use my referral link in the description to get $5 off your first order. So thank you again to PCBWay for making this project possible, and now let's get back to work. The enclosure I designed to hold the radio module and microcontroller has some really cool features I want to tell you about. First up is the snap-on lid I designed. In the past, when I've designed boxes like this, I've used screw-down lids that leave a really big, ugly gap around the side. With this box, I designed the snap-on lid that just press fits in and has a lip on the inside to make sure that it's not a really ugly seam around the edge. This snap-on lid works by having this triangle protrudy part on both sides of the enclosure stick into these open parts right here on the lid. So when you press the lid on, it actually bends out these walls on the enclosure and they snap back in place. And then when it's time to take the lid off, you can use a screwdriver to basically pry off the top. The other thing I'm really happy with is this backplane I designed. Basically, it's a little 3D printed support structure on the back that holds all the little electronic components together. This way, when I need to take it out to work on the electronics or while I'm wiring, I can just wire directly in here without having to worry about getting my fingers in the tiny little box. And then once it's totally wired, I can just slide it in and screw it down as one cohesive unit. I designed this backplane part by basically importing a 3D model of each of the electronic modules I'm going to include in this design, and then basically laying them out and drawing out this shape beneath it. The other thing I experimented with when printing out this box was using the fuzzy skin setting of Cura. Basically what this does is it adds a lot of random noise to the printer head on the outer layers of the print, so it kind of makes it fuzzy and not so obvious that it's a 3D print. I think it came out all right, but it's still pretty clearly a 3D print. I designed these laser gun targets in much the same way, except I didn't need a backplane for this, because it's all mounted on one singular PCB. I have two styles of these housings. This one is meant to be hung off of a wall with a push pin off of this tab. Then this one is meant for floor or table mounting, and it just sits flat on this ledge. And then there's the same mechanism for the lid. They snap on just like the radio enclosures, but they have these curved triangular bits instead of the flat ones like on the radio. I also added this paper diffuser to better show the color of the LEDs. I actually designed these enclosures on a live stream, so if you want to dig deeper into my design process, be sure to subscribe to follow with any future live streams I do. So now that I've got all the radio modules built, it's time to install them, measure them, and start testing them. So I have three modules. One is going in that corner over there on an outlet, one is going over there, and one is going to end up over there. That forms a rough triangle around the ride space. First, I have to carefully measure all of the radio module's locations to a coordinate grid. And what I'm actually thinking is I'm gonna have the XY coordinate start here in this corner. This will be the X direction, and this will be the Y direction. So now let's get all these modules installed into the wall, measure, and then look at some basic test code just to verify that the whole system's working. All right, this is a major progress update. I've got the trilateralization working. So I have a marker set up in all three corners like we talked about before, and then this tag right here is actually the marker that's gonna end up on the vehicle. So each of those markers in the three corners are measuring the distance from this tag and then reporting them back over Wi-Fi to my laptop. And then I went ahead and took each of those measured distances and plugged it into the trilateralization algorithm that we're gonna talk about here in a minute. And I'm getting a really accurate result. So let's take a look at how that trilateralization system actually works. Each UWB module will give you the distance from itself to the vehicle. Now, basically what that means is the vehicle can be anywhere within this circle. So if you imagine we're this far away from marker B, that means we can be anywhere within this circle. Now, if we have three markers, we know where we are by lining up where the three circles intersect. That works great for when you have perfect measurements and you know exactly where they are. You can see it lines up really well. But then if I inject some noise into the measurements So let's say I'm not exactly sure where the markers are. I had to use a tape measure, so it's not perfect. And there's noise from the actual readings of the UWB markers. There's nowhere these circles line up perfectly. Now, I made the noise here really intense just to demonstrate how that there's nowhere it lines up perfectly. In the real world, it's not this bad. So I've reduced that noise a little bit to make it more realistic. But you can see that there's still not a perfect spot where all the circles line up. So to solve where we think the vehicle is, we actually use a method called least squares. Now, I won't get too deep into the mechanics of least squares, but basically it's a way of minimizing the error in a system. In this case, I'm defining the error as the difference between the distance between the estimated position and the marker position versus the measured distance by the UWB modules. Now, because distance isn't a linear function, this actually has to be done recursively. Basically, you take the gradient at your estimated position, set that to zero, and solve for a new estimated position. You do this over and over again until the estimated position isn't changing anymore. That's when you know you've got the best estimated position you can get. Now, I know I threw in some linear algebra and some multivariable calculus concepts in there, so if you don't get that, that's fine, because you don't really need to. Python's a great language. It's so good that I only need a few lines of code to even implement this. Now that we've got trilateralization working, let's take this tag, put it on the vehicle along with an inertial measurement unit, and then we can focus on the Kalman filter that's really going to make this system work. So now it's time to take that tag and put it on the vehicle. But as long as I'm working on the vehicle, I actually think now is going to be a really good time to kind of clean up the vehicle. Through all my iterations, it's gotten pretty messy with all the wiring and leftover sensors that I'm not using anymore. So now is going to be a good time to take that all off, clean up the wiring, and then install the marker and the IMU. And while I'm at it, I'll tear up all these ArUco markers too, since I won't need them anymore. So I've got the radial module and the IMU installed on the vehicle now. One weird part about this is that neither of them actually have screw holes to mount them down, so I ended up making basically a block to hot glue them onto. Hot glue is kind of perfect for this. It doesn't have any conductive properties, it's low temp enough to not damage any of the electronics, and it's easily removable if it needs to come off in the future. And then I also had to glue that block down with hot glue because I don't want to take the vehicle all apart and take the seat off to add more screw holes to this plate. And then I went ahead and added the wiring for these modules to talk to the Raspberry Pi on board. And because I'm in the mode of cleaning up all the electronics, I also went ahead and cleaned up the schematic so that it matches what's built on the vehicle right now. So now that that's installed, what I'm going to do next is power on the vehicle and start tracking the location of the vehicle using trilateralization and a Kalman filter. Check it out! As I'm driving the vehicle around manually, it's tracking the location of it using the UWB modules, the wheel odometry, and the IMU data. Let's talk about how all of that is done through a Kalman filter. A Kalman filter is a sensor fusion algorithm. That means I'm going to fuse the data from the wheel odometry, from the gyroscopes on the IMU, and from the UWB trilateralization system to get a really accurate estimate of where the vehicle is in the room. The system starts with wheel odometry and the gyroscopes. It uses sensors on the wheels to measure how much they've spun, and from that I can compute how far forward or backwards we've gone. And then the gyroscope on the vehicle measures how much it's turned left or right. I use that data 100 times a second on the predict step of the Kalman filter. So every hundredth of a second, I take the current pose estimate and then add how far forward we've gone and how much we've turned. And then you get the Kalman update step. The update step runs whenever I get data from the UWB trilateralization system. This is an absolute measurement, unlike wheel odometry and the gyroscope data, which is relative. When I get an update from the trilateralization system, it tells me exactly where in the room it is, but with some noise added on top. So a Kalman gain is calculated based on the covariance from the previous prediction step and the hard-coded variance I have on the UWB measurement. It then uses that Kalman gain to decide whether to trust the UWB measurements or the prediction step estimate more. But here's something really cool about a Kalman filter. You'll notice I don't actually have any absolute measurement of the vehicle's heading, of which way it's facing. I have the gyroscope data, but that's only relative. It tells me how far it's turned, but not exactly which way it's facing. But the Kalman filter can actually figure that out. Because the motion of the vehicle is dependent on which way it's facing, it can only go forwards and backwards, not side to side, we can actually use that to figure out which direction the vehicle is facing. So if the position from the UWB estimate does not match the position estimate from the predict step, it will actually go back, move the vehicle to the UWB position, and then calculate the heading that it would have to be facing for it to get there. So when I start up the ride, it doesn't actually know which way it's facing. So I have to manually drive it around the room a little bit, and in that time, it figures out which way it's facing using the update steps. So the Kalman filter is a really great way to fuse the data from all these sensors to figure out where the vehicle is. And just like I mentioned in the least squares section, Python is a great language and it's really easy to implement stuff like this with libraries already pre-built. Now that we have the UWB-based tracking figured out, it's actually really easy to get it working. Because I used modular programming when I was writing the code to actually make the vehicle follow a ride profile in the last video, I don't actually need to rewrite it. All I have to do is replace the ArUco code with the UWB code, and just like that, it's working. So now we have all the individual components working. We have the laser targets set up. We have the UWB module ready to go. So let's see how well this system works. So there we go, that's the best this ride has ever worked. If you like this video, be sure to hit the like button and make sure to subscribe to see the next video where we're gonna tie this to synchronized sound and synchronized lighting to make this a real ride experience.